This year's dry season is bringing extra warm temperatures across the Philippines, no thanks to the El Nino phenomenon. State Weather Bureau Pagasa is forecasting the effects of the weather phenomenon may be felt until at least May, which means Filipinos will have to endure this searing heat for longer. Let's now talk about the economic costs of the extreme heat with Jonas Ravelas, consultant on financial services and strategy of EMBM. We're also joined by Zonibel Woods, senior social development specialist of the Asian Development Bank. So let's now talk about the agricultural sector. So it's one of the most affected by the El Nino phenomenon, and the damage is estimated to be at the 3 billion peso mark already. And some farmers are saying the damage could be more than that. The government is giving away subsidies to help farmers cushion the impact, but is that enough?
Okay, I think when we talk about the impact of El Nino and eventually the heat, we can only think about agricultural productivity. So since the issue of inflation came in during the first year of BBM, they've already provided mitigating circumstances. So they provided subsidies to the farmers, to the transport sector in trying to fight inflation, no? So the problem really is that it takes time to improve agricultural productivity. So this is eventually the challenge at a time when we have this severe El Nino. No? So, and of course, we have no choice but to deal with it. And dealing with it is importation. At the same time, despite the importation that we have, we still need to have that productivity. And the only thing that we can do is really to continue all of these necessary measures. So I guess from the agricultural perspective, it's really trying to do climate resilient infrastructures. So at the same time, we need to improve on post-harvest facilities. The second is sustainable agricultural practices. So the government have done all of the subsidies. It's just that we need to educate farmers to be able to, you know, adopt this type of practices so that they'll improve productivity. And there are strains that are rice particularly that are able to be less water supportive.
Well, I'm really glad that you're starting this conversation with talking about the agricultural sector, because it is not just an important sector for the economy, but it is also an important sector for people's sort of livelihoods, communities, as well as sort of overall food security. So I think it's heartening to hear that the government is starting to address this issue, but addressing the impacts of intense heat waves, particularly in the agriculture sector, it necessitates an approach that is not just from the agriculture sector, but other sectors as well. So that means looking at this issue more holistically. So looking at sort of labor, how are we working with agricultural workers to support their participation? It's about water resources, looking at irrigation systems as well. It is also looking at energy and energy use. You know, one of the areas that when we talk to agricultural workers and farmers, one of the things that they always bring up is their access to cold storage for their produce. The fruits of their labor really get lost from the moment that they are picked off the fields to getting transported to markets. So I think it requires, as I said, a very much a holistic and comprehensive response, not just through the agricultural sector, but other sort of key sectors that provide support and resources to farmers.
You know, food is the most immediate impact of El Nino. And, you know, obviously with those things happening, we can expect higher food prices. But what else should the Philippines be ready for because of the high heat? I mean, what other sectors are affected by the El Nino phenomenon?
The heat, no? So that means the demand for use of electricity is there. So if this continues and we don't do climate-related activities like cloud seeding, then definitely we might create a big demand for power, and definitely that will mean higher costs, health. So we've seen this in start of the year, no? Diseases brought about by whether it's driven by the lack of water. Again, this is still connected to climate change. That will mean higher healthcare costs. The other thing is tourism. The impact definitely is that you don't want to go out, diba? Or you will actually attract less tourists in this type of situation. So then that will also mean lesser growth.
I work as a gender specialist, so I come to this issue from that perspective. So to what extent it's going to affect women, and in particular, poor women. So one of the things that we have been looking at, and it's also relevant to the agriculture sector, but other sectors of the economy, like informal workers, of which women sort of are a large part of. Construction is also another area. So anyone that works outdoors will be affected by heat stress. And the data that we're seeing from the International Labor Organization, for example, is that there will be a significant productivity loss from heat waves. If you can imagine, you know, heat generally slows all of us down. Our ability to move, our ability to think, you know, one of the challenges will be for those who are working outdoors. But also in terms of energy, when there are increased heat waves, there's an increased demand for energy. And so domestic demand for energy. So the energy sector will have to adapt and think about sort of how it may realign some of the priorities, the supply issues, and so on during sort of heat waves. But heat waves generally, I think we need to look at them as something that are here to stay, even if we stopped carbon emissions tomorrow. The planet is already on a course to continue to warm. And so we need to be able to adapt and also prevent, you know, some of the consequences. So, for example, the health system, looking at how the health system is actually ready to address the health-related issues, such as increased incidences of kidney disease. In some countries in the region, we have an aging society. So how will we cope with sort of the impacts of heat stress on people? And finally, if I can say one more sector that I think we need to really pay attention to is the education sector. We have seen in the Philippines recently school closures, and because of the heat wave, because both teachers and students were fainting because it was so hot in the classrooms. We actually have data about how heat impacts students' ability to study, to do well in exams, and it basically impacts young people's cognitive ability to solve problems. And so when we have schools that lack the facilities to keep students cool, this will have huge impacts in the long run.
How do you think the extreme heat will affect overall economic growth in the Philippines? Are your economists actually reducing your GDP growth forecast because of this El Nino phenomenon?
we have seen in the last, I would say, in the last year, an increased interest in sort of looking at how heat waves are going to impact economic growth. What I can tell you is that data is really uneven across the region. But we do have some projections for other countries, such as, you know, Cambodia. There's projections of, you know, depending on which climate scenario, it could reduce GDP by up to, you know, 30%. And then already we're looking, you know, at some data from studies that say that if we have increased heat waves, for example, in home-based work in India, they already, home-based workers are reporting a massive decrease in their income during heat waves. So I think this is something, as you rightly point out, that economists should be incorporating in their forecasting for future growth in the countries around the region.
I think initially, mainly because we look at it from a perspective of the impact of agriculture, energy, health, and eventually tourism. There's the other side. Given that we have so much heat, this is the best time to do infrastructure spending. And I think in the recent adjustment of economic targets, and finally the government through Secretary Baliksakan, no, highlighted that this will all be driven by infrastructure. So given that we're able to do this, the other side of the positive end is that they can continue to do the infrastructure spending. So that, again, that could offset the negative impact of these things, no? So the question is, it's really more of executing all of this infrastructure spending. Although I guess we've seen this during the Holy Week, that there were certain roads that were being fixed, no, during the Holy Week. So there should be more of this type of activity so that we take advantage of this scorching heat. No?
So what should the government do to reduce the adverse impact of dry weather conditions? So what long-term investments can be made so that we will be more weather resilient?
We really need to look at what will be the resources that we have available to us in the future. And and what are the things that we can do that are low cost and that people in communities can do? Because at the end of the day, we are talking about increasing the resilience of communities to adapt and be able to survive these heat waves. And so some of the things that are being done in other countries, and I think in the Philippines, there have been some important initiatives around this, is around passive cooling. So clearly we need more green spaces that provide shade and cooling. We've seen amazing transformations of cities around the world that before were all built environments and are now incorporating green spaces, are incorporating water features and other types of infrastructure that not only support sort of the cooling of the environment, but also address other issues such as pollution and other sort of, you know, mental health as well, which is something that is also affected by heat stress. So I think those are some of the things that we can look forward to prepare. We cannot prepare for a future where more people use air conditioning. So, but we can prepare for a future that is greener and that supports sort of, you know, a better way of living in a better ecosystem for people.
Yeah, hopefully we'll invest in infrastructure so that if ever we do have another El Nino, such as what we're suffering from right now, we should be able to address it better and, as you said, stay resilient.